at News Radio KMAN.
This is In Focus on News Radio 1350 KMAN.
And a good morning. It's now 9:07 at News Radio KMAN, and we're shaking things up a little bit today. We have a very special edition of KMAN's In Focus. It is a personal story that is delicate in a lot of respects. And we have several guests in the studio, and I'm going to turn things over today to our very special guest host, longtime KMAN News Director Kathy Dawes, has broken free from that from the chains of retirement.
Chains of retirement. I feel like I'm busier in some ways than I was when I was working here. But yes, Kathy Dawes Scroggs, many of course remembering me as Dawes. It's been a year and a half since I was sitting in this chair, I do believe. Was here for nearly 17 years. But it's not about me today at all. It's about you, Shireti. And she, of course, is Manhattan City Commissioner, two times past mayor, former Manhattan Ogden NEA representative, which is how we met, in fact. You started doing reports for me on that. Also very involved with mental health issues with NAMI and that type of thing. And I will say that we've been close friends for a long time. We're PEO sisters.
For several years.
And we have many things that we've worked together on. Robin Cole, Executive Director of Pawnee Mental Health, also joining us today. And this seems very natural to have Robin in the studio. Barry Wilkerson, Riley County Attorney, also one person that I had the opportunity to visit with many a time during my 16, 17 years here at KMAN. I do want to say before we get things started, we are not allowing phone calls today. Yusha's story is just too important. We want her to share this very intense, Dave used the word delicate earlier this morning, very delicate personal story. We want this to be her time and her time to share this story. And that brings us to why we are here. And I'm sure a lot of folks out there are wondering, what's going on here? Why is Yusha here? Why is the county attorney here? Why is Robin Cole here? Well, there is a reason for that. And that's because Yusha will be sharing, as I say, an intense and really kind of a horrifying story in some respects regarding her childhood with us today. And I'm truly honored, Yusha, to be able to help you tell the story. I think it's something the community needs to know. I know that you wanted to share it with Manhattan before anybody else heard about it. And at this point, and I'll help you along the way, but I'll let you tell us some of the basics of why you're here today.
Okay. Well, thanks a lot, Kathy, and I really appreciate Barry and Robin being here with me, as well as Corey and Dave giving me a chance to do this kind of my way. And having you here with me, it makes it more comfortable. So most of the community in Manhattan knows me either as a teacher or union rep or public servant and as their elected official. And my personal life has always been very separate than my public life, and that very intentionally so. But unfortunately, my personal life and my public life are going to be intersecting here sooner. The reason being, you know, the public knows me in a variety of ways, but the other part to my narrative is that I'm also a victim of sexual assault. And the perpetrator in this instance happens to be my father. This is the first time I'm discussing it publicly, and the reason I picked today is because he was convicted and pleaded guilty to sexual assault and rape on Friday, July 19th. So that was just last Friday. So, you know, news like this spreads quickly, and I never know how they're going to represent this. So I felt Manhattan is my family, and they need to hear it from my voice. So I didn't put anything out there in writing or anything of that sort. And everything I've ever done in my life was to put this behind me and move forward. So people never really thought of me as a victim of sorts in this instance. But that is the case. I've never really talked about it with anybody. So this happened to me between the ages of 10 and 16. I was fifth grade until about 10th or 11th grade. And I've told several people along the way. And, you know, I think as a victim, most people just want to get on with their normal life. And I was one of those people. I just wanted a normal life and to move forward. And I have done that. And I've been successful in my career as well as raising my children. But along with that, it never leaves you. You know, it doesn't define me, but it is part of my identity. And after my divorce, I was with my children, and this happened to have come up once again where I had to. I felt I needed to tell my children because there were questions about why I was being so overprotective of them. And that led to where one of my children wanted justice. And it was a very vulnerable time. And because they needed to have that type of justice, we were able to set up a meeting with my middle son and myself and my dad, and recorded a conversation where he was at. My dad was asked questions by my son about why he did this. Did this happen? And so all of that was recorded. So we had evidence, and that was about 9 or 10 years ago. And we were ready to pursue charges in Ohio because that's where I lived for most of my life. Unfortunately, they had statute of limitations, and we couldn't move forward. So we just let that go, and we kept going on with life. At that point, that's when my brothers and my other family members found out. And then it came to where one of my son again felt like, you know, why isn't anything being done? How come he gets to go and do whatever he wants with life, and you get to live this lie? Why do we have to live a lie? So that's when I was thinking about how to resolve this and bring it to justice. And that's when I called Barry. And, you know, being a district attorney, I was confused about statute of limitations. And I was telling him, can we do something at the federal level? How can I do this? And we talked about where it started. And it started in Virginia from ages 10 to 12, 75 to 77, 1975 to 1977. And so when I called the, I reported it to the police in Virginia. And at that point, it was out of my hands. Once the Commonwealth of Virginia had enough evidence, you don't have that choice anymore. They have to follow the charges. So he was extradited from Texas. We went through lots of court hearings, lots of plea bargaining, and then we finally came to an agreement, and the judge agreed to the plea bargaining that we came up with. And I think the culminating result was the conviction.
He also, I believe, mm-hmm. a fairly prominent doctor, too, which I'm sure made things even more difficult for you at the time to come forward and say anything to anyone. And I believe that mm-hmm. his license has been revoked, too.
Yes, yeah. And this often happens. It's a power struggle. And a child is never in a good situation to report these things. And, you know, rape and sexual assault don't have anything to do with race, ethnicity, SES, none of that. It happens across the board to anybody. And the more women I would tell, they also had a story similar to mine or something along those lines, whether it's with workplace or date rape or within their families that they never told anybody about. And so I became that sounding board for them.
It's interesting because I'm reading a story right now about Doris Day of all people, and she was abused by her first husband, and you know, but she also talked about her father and some of the things that went on. And I think a child sometimes is afraid to report it. They're mm-hmm. afraid, what's going to happen to my family?
Right.
Are my brothers and sisters going to go to foster care? What's going to happen to my family? And I think you probably mm-hmm. wrestled with some of that too, and whether people would even believe you at that point.
And I think that goes throughout your life. I think oftentimes the way society is set up is we take the blame. A victim often blames themselves that they must have had something to do with this. And that needs to be removed immediately. Because anytime you file charges, it's the onus falls on the victim to prove that it happened, unfortunately. So to even say something, you have to make sure you have enough evidence of some kind to bring it forward. And yes, you want a normal life. You know, I never played the victim card in any role, any hat I've ever had. But this time that was the case that I had to wear that hat because sometimes people might assume the perpetrator is the victim. And I wanted to make clear that that's not the case. It takes a while for it to come out.
And you've been fortunate, too, to have a lot of support. I know I see your husband, Brian, there mm-hmm. sitting in the corner watching you very proudly. I mean, you have him. You have your children backing you up. You have some resources now. It's difficult to go through a process like this, but this was the right time.
Yeah, it absolutely is. And, you know, I work in a school environment where I see this with children all the time. The system itself, the criminal justice system in this case, you know, there are gaps and it fails a lot of people, but in my instance, it did work for me. The prosecutor in Virginia was really good with the way she worked with me and defining the difference between justice and revenge. And, you know, when you're angry, I wanted revenge. As you know, I want to get him for everything that I can. He needs to suffer. But as more discussions took place, it was obvious that if we had gone to trial, my children would have been brought in, people would have been subpoenaed, and he could have gotten away with a not guilty or with a hung jury, and neither one of those was acceptable. And right now, with the plea bargaining the way it happened, there was a public apology where he actually used the word sexual assault and rape and apologized for doing that to me. And that wasn't the case before. Before, the apologies were always, I'm sorry I did that to you.
Exactly. So. Well, and let's bring Barry and Robin into the discussion just a bit, too. And Dave, be sure to let me know when I need to go to breaks, too. You know, motion to me like the olden days. But we'll bring Barry in on this. And apparently you had shared this with Barry at one point. I know the statute of limitations played a part in not going to Ohio to file charges. And Barry helped you out a little bit with that. Barry, I know you've worked on cases. In fact, just to share with folks, back in 2004, I interviewed him for a child abuse series that I did. That seems appropriate at a time like this. And I know he shared some early stories during his, when he was a young, you know, attorney that he had to deal with. But when you see a case like this, I mean, is it rather unusual for it to be this many years that have transpired? And then, of course, then you have to deal with statute of limitations, that type of thing.
This length of time, it is unusual. There are a lot of these cases out there that have never seen the light of day and probably won't. Fortunately, Virginia, there was no statute of limitations, so they were able to prosecute this case. And I would commend the prosecutors in Virginia for going forward with the charges. And obviously, you know, the courageous courage in seeking justice in this matter. Like I said, a lot of times these cases never see the light of day, so I really, you know, just my hat's off to Yusha in bringing this to light and also coming forward and empowering other victims. But, you know, Kansas now is, we don't have a statute of limitations any longer. Had this occurred in Kansas when it did, we would not have been able to go forward. That has since changed. I believe it was 2012 or 13. I'd have to go back and look. But, you know, if this happens to somebody, you know, 30 years from now, we would be able to prosecute it if it happened today. So we're seeing a lot of those changes across the country, which I think is good.
And Robin, you know, when we talk about the mental health aspect, this has to be something, as Yusha said, she kind of put it back, you know, she separated her personal life from her public life. And all too many people probably do this, but I imagine you work with folks that have been through this that maybe never did come forward.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that, you know, when any of us look at Yusha, we see somebody who is a very accomplished, professional, competent, capable woman who has done so much for this community, both at an individual level, you know, the micro level of interactions with individual people, and then also at more of a macro level in terms of just wanting to implement justice for all people. And now we know part of what has just driven her to be so just so heartfelt and so persistent about making sure that justice occurs for everyone in the community and everyone that she interacts with. And I think she's an example of a person who's taken something that was so wrong and so vile and turned it into something that really allowed her to just serve the community in ways that none of us could ever imagine.
On that note, let's go ahead and go to a break, and we'll come back and explore this more, maybe some numbers of this.
Absolutely.
Happens all too often to a lot of folks.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
The K-Man Morning Show is brought to you by Manhattan. Show is brought to you by Manhattan. Show is brought